Together. Father, we thank you so much for your help. Thank you for your many, many, many blessings and favors. Lord, even at this moment, we are trusting you to open up your mouth and speak to your children. We are set for you. Please come and help us again by your word, because your word is your agent for everything you will do in life. We receive it by the power and understanding of the Holy Spirit in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, friends. It's wonderful to know that you are out there and that you are tuned in to this telecast. God bless you. We will go on again today. I've said to you before, and I will keep telling you all the time, don't be distracted. The enemy of our soul is using the situation around now to try to disrupt everybody's progress. We must go on until Christ comes. The news must not become the undoing. The news in the atmosphere is creating fear. Many people are trying to relocate. Many people are trying to do one thing or the other. Many people are trying to speculate. No, they are no longer praying, but they are speculating. People are moving without prayer. People are losing their faith because of fear. Let it not be your portion. Keep enjoying God. If you died and you are sure you're a believer, Stephen died. Any of us can die, but we're not preparing for death, because there's a life after death. We're preparing for glory. And the way to prepare for glory is to be doing the will of God until the day you come, either by natural death on your bed, or by accident, or by anything. It doesn't matter. We're not praying that you're going to die by accident. We're not going to be praying that you're going to be kidnapped and slaughtered. We're not praying that any such thing will happen to you, but we are praying that you be faithful to the end. That lack of money, lack of basic needs of life, which is not your portion. So I don't want to pray a prayer that is not realistic. The Bible says, if you seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness, everything like this will be added to you. Let us believe God and trust him. He is very faithful. Even in very hard times like this, I tell you, I hear people testifying to the faithfulness of God. I have not gone to bed without my meal. And I'm sure it's so with you. Somehow, God prevails. God wins. Say, he that is coming will come. I will not delay. Let me rush on to Genesis chapter 3, the terrible chapter of the Bible. It's in the Genesis. That's where the fall began. The fall began in the Genesis. Every evil began in Genesis. Every good began in Genesis. All the revelation that we need to live life is in the Genesis. Our study has not been very fast, even though we have not actually been as detailed as we should. But this time again, let us make a little more progress. I read from verse 16. Last time we stopped in verse 15. Yes, we have read verse 16. No, we have not read verse 16. We read verse 15. So let me read verse 15 again. And I just want to finish with this Genesis 3. I want to run away from it, if I could. And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over you. Now unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for thy sake. In sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth for thee to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field. In the sweat of your face shalt thou eat bread, till thou return unto the ground. For out of it was thou taken, for dust thou art, and unto dust shalt thou return. And Adam called his wife Eve, because it was the mother of all living. And Adam also said to his wife, did the Lord God, no, sorry, and sorry, and unto Adam and his wife, did the Lord God make coats of skin and clothed them? And the Lord God said, behold, the man is become as one of us, to know good and evil. And now lest he put forth his hand and take also of the tree of the life of life and eat and live forever. Therefore, the Lord God sent him forth from the Garden of Eden to till the ground from whence he was taken. And he drove out the man, and he placed at the east end of the Garden of Eden cherubim and a flaming sword, which turned every way to keep the way of life, of the tree of life. Hallelujah. There are two major trees in that garden, the tree of life and the tree of knowledge. The tree of knowledge is the one God said, don't eat it. I wonder why Adam didn't eat the tree of life to live forever. Men always prefer knowledge to life. Fat heads. Knowledge makes a man proud. And I see that naturally a man loves knowledge. They put knowledge before life, but God puts life before knowledge. But let's leave it until we come to it. So God now spoke. After speaking to the serpent, he spoke to the woman. And I'm not going to be in any detail to study what he told the woman. But he said to her, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. So that's the first thing about a woman. It's God who said that. It's not complimentary. I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. So a woman takes in by sorrow. And several women go through a very difficult pregnancy. From the day they take in to the day they give birth, many of them are on bed rest. Some vomit for so many months. Some always have one threat or the other. Pregnancy has become a very big sorrow. It's a result of the fall. It was not so in the beginning before the fall. I'd like you to know this so that you can be able to go back to God and say, Lord, this was not the case before the fall. I want you to bring me back to your original intention. I don't want to have pregnancy and pregnancy becomes a load, becomes a sorrow. No, Lord, please. You could claim that. You could return to the original. If there was no Genesis chapter 3, woman would not even know when she took it and when she delivered. But because of the disobedience and because of the fall, God had to speak like this. I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children. Oh, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he will rule over you. I'd like you to take note. I said we cannot go into this exhaustively, but let me show you that this is a result of the fall. That when Jesus restores you, you don't have to accept this. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children. So when a woman wants to bring forth a child, when a woman wants to give birth to a child, what they call the travail, is normally the pain. Yes, I've heard that there's nothing like it. But a woman told me that this is her fifth child and that she will not cry again. That she has cried for four, that this time around it's a walkover. I was outside the maternity waiting for her to come out. When I heard her cry again, and that cry is deep. Sometimes they become even psychiatric. That pain is a result of what happened after the fall. And so that shall bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband. Even despite all this sorrow in taking in, all this sorrow in pregnancy, all this sorrow in giving back, a woman still runs after a man. She still has a desire for her husband. You may be thinking that this is wonderful. No, no, no. This is not complimentary. And the man will rule over you. So all you men who are Hitlers, I don't know whether Hitler is the correct word. Hitler was the German ruler who wanted to kill all the Jews, an oppressor indeed. And several men are like him. You oppress your wife, you rule over your wife, you command your wife. You beat your wife, you do all kinds of things to her. Well, I don't know what to call you, but that thing that is happening there is not supposed to be. A man is not supposed to rule over a woman. Mm-mm. Mm-mm. They are partners, they are complementary. They are partners in progress. You should carry her along, no rule. There's a difference between to rule autocratically and to carry somebody along. But many men are tyrants, commanders, and your wife is living in trepidity and fear. She can't talk. She's afraid. And some of them are becoming very courageous. Eyeball to eyeball, they stand up to you. And you know the kind of terrible situation that has overtaken us. All this was not there in Genesis chapter 2. There was no quarrel in Genesis chapter 2. The woman was subject to the man. They were living for God. Things were smooth. There's no oppressor at that time. But when we come to chapter 3, the Bible said, woman, since you have misbehaved, and since you have confused your husband, and since you have made him do what I didn't want him to do, he will rule over you. Now it's no longer a matter of love. He will rule over you. And many maintain that that principle is a correct principle. You know it is a result of the fall. God didn't plan it like that before. That you should shout on your wife, you should be harsh with your wife, you should rule over her. You should tell her, stop that, sit down. No, that was not the original way God wanted it. It was because the woman went and did something wrong. And sister, if you will do well, if you will begin to obey your husband, if you will begin to obey the word of God, if you begin to live the kingdom lifestyle, God can remove all this from you. You can still have your babies, you can still be pregnant, you can still have a wonderful life. And your husband and yourself can be such partners that there's no need to rule anybody. But that's the situation after the fall. That's what has happened. But the Bible says you shall be delivered from childbirth if you do well. And I'm praying that you will do well, my sister. I'm just begging God that you will do well. I'm begging God that you will not put yourself under this kind of stress that women go through. Several women are going through terrible stress. They say, Satan, no, not first of all, Satan. I didn't see Satan here. All I see is this misbehavior. And then God turned to the man after the woman. Oh, the consequences of the fall is too deep. You can't appreciate. That's why the Bible says, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. There's a freedom that no human being has. Many things that happen to us because of this nature we have acquired because of the fall is too deep. It's not just that people are committing sin. There are several consequences that we are passing through which ought not to be. And I'm showing you this because you need to know it. This is where it started. And that the deliverer has come, the seed of the woman, to deliver us out of this. And unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of your wife, number one, and hast eaten the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for thy sake. In sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of your life. Now this is where they didn't curse the man. They cursed the ground. But look at the reason, so that you can understand it. Because you have listened and obeyed the voice of your wife, and you have eaten the tree which I commanded you not to eat, the ground is cursed for your sake. Because you have obeyed the voice of your wife, either because of fear or because of what, I don't know. But because you have obeyed the voice of some of you who will not obey the voice of God that he commanded you. You will obey the voice of your wife because you are afraid of the consequences of obeying God in your house. Your relationship with your wife is just not right. And because you are afraid that if you obey God, there is no more sleep in your house. So you obeyed the voice of your wife. Which voice are you obeying? Sister, it's not going to be good for you when your husband fears you and so doesn't obey God. It's not good for you when your husband is so afraid of what you will do and therefore he can't tell you the truth. It's not good for you when your husband cannot longer be the husband of his house because of how you normally react to small corrections. How you normally react to cancer. How you normally react to anything that happens in the house. You are so selfish and so independent minded. And you are prepared to fight at all times. That your husband is now in your pocket. It is not good for you. I am begging you. A woman that cannot accept simple correction is any human being that does not accept correction does not want to make progress. That's what the book of Proverbs says. A wise man receives correction and becomes wiser. A fool, even if you give him bolala, you see a fool. Friend, many of our homes are in topsy-turvy. Many of our homes are upside down. There's no head, there's no leader. There's no follower. Everybody in that house is the captain of the ship. That is not God. And that is why this man fell into a deep trouble. God didn't ask the woman, why did you give him? He said, why did you eat of what I said you should not eat? It doesn't matter who is making you to disobey God. That voice that is making you to disobey the voice of Almighty God. Sometimes the will of God is clearly spelled out. It's not ambiguous. But yet, because you are afraid of what will happen if you obey the voice of God, you compromise. Either in your office, but now mostly at home. That is why things are not going well. That is why the devil is having the upper hand. Because when the word of God comes, light comes. And when light comes, darkness goes away. But unfortunately, we can't even pray together. We can't even do anything good. Because you obey the voice of your wife. Therefore, the ground is cursed for your sake. Ah! In sorrow thou shalt eat all the days of your life. To eat now, man has to sweat. When he was in the garden, in Genesis chapter 2, everything he needed to eat was there. It was only to dress it. God took care of him. I hear Jesus saying, even today, that you don't have to struggle to eat. Take no thought for your life what you eat. I see a lot of people struggling to eat. Oh, they leave their house early in the morning to go to the shop or to the market. They come back late at midnight, and yet they can't sell anything. They go here, the Bible said, thorns and thistles shall the ground grow for you. And thorns and thistles are very terrible. You know, weeds, oh my God. You have to weed your farm 7 times. As you are trying to put manure on your corn, the weeds are overgrowing the manure. Your corn is already yellow. And many people labor, they get nothing out of it. You sweat and sweat and sweat under the sun. And yet, friend, you can go back to God if you follow Jesus and say, Lord, this is what your word says. Eh? Eh? And thou shalt eat food out of it. And thorns and thistles shall it bring forth. And thou shalt eat the herbs. You are going to eat what is growing out of itself, not the one I gave you. You will suffer to eat. I will show you this, that in the sweat of your face shall thou eat bread, till thou return to the earth, to the ground. What out of it was thou taken, for dust thou art, and unto dust shalt thou return. May the Lord help us to understand that this is not complementary, it's not the best, that every man must sweat. That principle is not God. I thank God I discovered it. I don't need to sweat. I need to work hard, not to eat. I work hard, not because I need to work hard to eat. I work hard because hard work is Jesus' virtue. It's recommended by Jesus. Jesus worked hard. But it's not because if you don't work hard, you will not eat. No. I work hard to provide others, not for me. It's a principle of life. I have chosen who to follow. If you follow Adam, you will sweat. If you follow Jesus, and you understand Jesus very well, and you want to live a simple life of peace and contentment, you will not sweat. Actually, God does not want to see sweat on your brow. When I saw people saying they are serving God and they are sweating, I say, no. It's not God you are serving and you are sweating. Serve the Lord with gladness. If it's God you are serving, and we have to live on purpose. God has a purpose for everybody. But when you miss it, so when they drove the man out of the garden, and I'm going to come to that, he was no longer in the proper location where everything was good, and I was driven out. I don't know where you're located now. I don't know whether you have been displaced from where you ought to be. Friend, why we are studying this is because you need to know, it's not Satan causing your trouble. Lord will help you. And Adam called his wife Eve because she was the mother of all living. This is where this principle came in. He called his wife Eve. You now call your wife something because of something. He's no longer a woman because she was taken out of man by revelation. It's now because she's the mother of all living. So if you call your wife darling in the morning, in the night, and you call her stupid in the morning, you call your wife not according to revelation. Now this principle has come. We now see Eve, because she's the mother of all living. And unto Adam and to his wife Eve, did the Lord God make coats of skins, and he clothed them. The Lord will help you to understand this. They used to use leaves to cover themselves. Now God came and gave them a skin covering. And for God to cover them with skin of an animal, it means he killed an animal and shed blood. Now these are serious principles. If God must deliver you, stop covering. Stop using leaves. Leaves will fade. There's no way you can cover. In fact, it is hypocrisy to cover. Anybody who is cover is just a hypocrite. And there's nothing hidden that will not be made manifest. There's nothing you are covering or you are trying to put in the secret that will not come to the open. Why don't you go to God and let him cover you? Only God can cover a man effectively. And that covering is a covering of the coat of skins. Fantastic coats. Explicitly made in the heavenly tellers. But it costs blood, the blood of a life. And God is already beginning to show the solution to the problem. On the cross of Calvary, Christ shed his blood. And that blood is what effectively covers us and gives us a new clothing. Hallelujah. Friend, have you come to Jesus? You can't succeed by your own personal effort. Your effort of wearing leaves, can't you see that it is too costly? You quarrel with your wife, but you will not want anybody to know that you are living in a terrible situation. And so nobody can help you. Nobody can be used by God to help you. I didn't say you should go and broadcast your case on NTA. But at least there should be somebody that you are confidently taking into confidence who can go to God with you. And God will send the blood of covering. The blood of Jesus Christ speaketh better thing than the blood of Abel. He doesn't speak vengeance. He speaks mercy. And that blood we are going to come to that when we are going to read. But you see, many people are misusing the blood. Someone is going to pray for me. He said, let the Lord tar the road between Kaduna and Abuja with the blood because I'm traveling. I said, no. That's not the reason for the blood. It's not to tar road. Kota is what they use to tar road. But because of lack of revelation and knowledge, many of us are misusing these things that God has provided for our salvation. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. So that is why in the Old Testament, every time a man commits, he must bring a victim, an animal, and shed his blood. And when Jesus Christ came, there's no more sacrifice, animal sacrifice. The one sole complete sacrifice has been offered. Friend, anytime you see people offering animal sacrifice, it's not God who commanded them to do it. We are finished with that dispensation. We now rely on the one offering of Jesus, which is incorruptible, which is forever settled, which is the price that paid for your ransom, the imperishable, incorruptible blood of Jesus that delivered us from the impossible road to heaven. All of us are in the possible road. We can't get to heaven without blood. So God clothed them. Then God said, and the Lord God said, verse 22, behold, the man is become like one of us to know good and evil. And now lest he put forth his hand and take also of the tree of life and eat it and live forever. Therefore the Lord God sent him forth from the garden of Eden to till the ground from whence he was taken. Calamity, progressive. The fall was not, it was progressive. And as I read it, I pity myself, even though I'm glad that Jesus has delivered me. And until he delivers you, brother, you are in a deep ditch, you are in a deep pit. God says, since he has lost his innocence, man was innocent at the beginning. He didn't know right from wrong. He only knew what God told him. But after the fall, his eyes opened. And God said, because, behold, the man is become as one of us. He knows good and evil. And lest he put forth his hand and also take the tree of life and live forever. Therefore, the Lord God drove him away from the garden and sent him outside the garden to go and till the ground and suffer. Friend, I'd like to pray with you. He drove out the man and he placed on the east of the Garden of Eden cherubims and a flaming sword, which turned every way to keep the way to the tree of life. Drove the man away, put cherubim with a sword at the gate. Any man that must return now to eat the tree of life in the garden must go through the sword. I will come to that when we are discussing some things. Except you go through the sword, you can't enter the garden again. You cannot take the tree of life. You will die. You will be a dead man. But it's interesting that God removed him from that location. Every human being who is not born again, who is of Adam's race, is outside God's program, is outside God's purpose, is outside the garden. But that's not my biggest pain. My pain is that some people who are born again are not inside the garden. They are outside, filling the ground. Sin drives a man away from where God placed him. There's a divine placement for every man who is in the Lord, who God has made. When a man lives in sin, you are displaced. You can't stay in the garden. You are dislocated. Many of you are dislocated. Many of you are displaced. Many of you are outside the will of God and the kingdom. I want to pray with you right now. Repent and come back. Ask God that even if it means you have to pass through the sword, you are going to return and eat the tree of life. Ask God to cover you with the coats of skin, which comes out of the blood of Jesus. Ask him to show you mercy now. Confess your sins to him. Return to the Savior. There's no more offering to be offered. Let's pray. Father, thank you because you didn't leave man in the pit and into which he fell. You looked at him inside the pit and you said, if you will confess, I will pull you out. If you will fall, if you will repent and look to me. But many are in the pit now. Even those who said they are born again, they are not in the garden. They have been displaced. They have been misplaced. They have been dislocated. They are tilling the earth. They are fighting with thorns and thistles. They are sweating. But Lord, it's their choice. If they make a choice now to come back to you and return to the garden, there's a tree of life. There's a tree of life. There's a fruitfulness that will become their portion. Father, because you are a righteous God, you will not change rules and change goalposts for any man. You have laid it out in your word. Help us to return to you. Help us to stop covering up. Help us to expose everything the way we are and receive this covering from you. Satan is not our problem. It's because we didn't run to you. As many as are running to you right now, husbands and wives, who say we don't want to be under the curse anymore, but I rescue them. Remove the curse and cause that, Father, they will enter into the place of pleasure and peace and plenty. Thank you because you will do far more beyond what we can ask now. Thank you because there are many who are being revived and being delivered from this particular time. Lord, receive them and make them champions in a few times to come.